OCMSN.
Welcome. This is OCMSN, and this is our third broadcast of the year. I'm Bria Fennick.
And I'm Gabe Swarm. In light of the recent tragic shooting at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School, located in Parkland, Florida, which claimed the lives of 17 students and injured 14 others, we at OCMSN would like to reflect. Bria?
Let's step back from our busy lives for a moment and remember to be kind to one another. Respect our differences and pull together as a school in order to set an example to the rest of the world. Gabe?
Speak up against bullying. When you see it take place, think about what you say to other people. Words can and do matter. Bria?
Let the tragic events that happened in Florida be a reminder to us all that life is precious. We only get one life. And that there is enough violence in the world that none of us need to add to the pile.
Here at Oyo City Middle School, we can make a difference. Let's stand united against violence in our schools. We can always do better.
Just remember to believe in yourself.
To be kind as others, as well as being positive and humble.
One act of kindness leads to another.
Be amazing.
A compliment a day can save a life and make a friend a day.
To spread positivity, you have to show positivity.
Be the good, not the bad.
Don't make fun of the clothes people wear. It might be all they can afford. Don't be the reason why someone is sad about what they wear.
Giving a person a compliment a day make their day better.
Whenever it's raining, look for rainbows. Whenever it's dark, look for stars.
I think we can make the school a better place by staying happy.
Good people are good people.
Instead of wasting your time being negative, be positive.
Stand up for what you believe in, even if it means standing alone.
We now take you to Alex Webster with our spotlight story, The Middle School Play. Alex?
Thank you, Bria and Gabe, for that reflective opener. For the past 2 years, Oyo City Middle Schoolers have had the opportunity to participate in a relatively new experience, the Middle School Play. This year, the Drama Club had the pleasure of performing a musical entitled One Magic Moment. This musical also had a new team of directors. After assisting last year, Sinead Jackson, a junior, decided to take the position as director. Music was under the direction of senior Truman Butler. Choreographer was senior Morgan Gibson, and technical director was Jim Amaro, also a senior. I had the opportunity to sit down with each of them and discuss what it took to make the magic happen. I had the chance to catch up with Shanae. So, why did you decide to do a musical instead of a play?
Well, I decided to do a musical instead of a play because in the past we've done plays, and because I've had more experience with musicals than plays, and I kind of wanted to share that experience with the drama kids.
Believe it or not, many people don't know the difference between a play and a musical. So what exactly is the difference?
Okay, so within both a play and a musical, you are sharing a story, you are telling it through acting. But within a musical, you are using song and dance to further show what's happening, and show the plot, and show all the characters and who they are through that. So.
Thank you, Shanae.
Mm-hmm.
I'm here with Truman Littler. So, Truman, I heard that rehearsals were your first experience playing the piano in front of people.
Yeah, they were my first experience. I really enjoyed having to, you know, learn how to help people with different voice parts, having to teach chorus parts. It's been a very good experience for me.
What did you find to be the most rewarding about your time as musical director?
I think that having different people doing different things on stage at one time, then by the end of it, everything finally comes together. That definitely is the most rewarding part for me.
Thank you, Truman.
Jaden. How do you spell your first name?
J-A-D-E-N.
Where's Eric? G-O-U-G-H-L-E-R.
Boys can be so unfeeling.
Morgan.
So, Morgan, what dance experience did you have prior to the show?
I did gymnastics for quite a few years, and so I'd always make up my routines or help others. And then I did dance for a few years, and I joined Sapphires when I got into high school, and it's just, you get to learn dances, and then a few years later I got to start choreographing, and I really enjoyed it.
What did you learn from your experience as a choreographer?
Gotta be patient. Teaching like these kids, like I have to make sure that everybody is capable of doing what I'm like showing and teaching, and make sure that everyone, I'm trying to like push the kids out of their comfort zones and make it so they feel comfortable and confident in what they're doing. So.
Thank you, Morgan.
Bye.
I'm here with Jim. So, Jim, can you explain what the technical director's job entails?
Well, a number of things, actually. In my opinion, with our show that we're doing, that is a vast number of jobs and assignments and things like that. Normally, in a theatrical production, you would just be in charge of basically making everything technical-wise goes properly. So lights, sounds, fly rail, people moving things on and off stage, mics dying is a big one for me. I'm on a 24/7 dead sprint during the high school show to make sure those don't go down. But in the middle school show, especially since it's just myself, Shanae, and Truman, I am also the set designer, props guy, and a whole array of other jobs that I get to do. So, yeah, quite a bit.
How much time did you spend building the set?
That is a very good question. I mean, I would love to give you, you know, the big, be able to say like, 300 hours or something like that. I honestly don't know. I can tell you that I started planning as the high school musical was starting, because as part of the set build, Mr. Luxbacher is nice enough to allow me to cannibalize part of the high school set for your middle school show, and so I have to be able to tell him before the show is over what I want to keep and what he can completely tear down back to basics and send back down to our storage room in the basement. So I probably started maybe end of October, early November, and I'm still working on it now. It's been an adventure, and I'm a little bit pressed for time. We're like 2-3 weeks out, and I'm get kind of nervous because I still have a very long to-do list. But I have a wonderful crew of helpers, high school wise, Krista Myers and Bethany Roberts, and Zach Dempsey and Lauren DeGroat, and obviously a whole bunch of middle schoolers that I will be beginning to include next week. So I think we'll be fine. It's going to be.
Thank you, Jim, for your time.
You're very welcome.
Now our voices join together in a song of unity.
have a quarrel. It almost breaks my heart, 'cause I'm so afraid that we will have to part. Each night I ask the stars up above, why must I be a teenager in love? One day I feel so happy, the next day I feel so sad. I guess I'll learn to take the good with the bad. 'Cause each night I ask the stars up above, why must I be a teenager in love? I cried a tear for nobody but you. I'll be a lonely one if you should say we're through. Well, if you want to make me cry, that won't be so hard to do. If you should say goodbye, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above, why must I be a teenager in love? I cried a tear for nobody but you. I'll be a lonely one if you should say we're through. Well, if you want to make me cry, that won't be so hard to do. And if you should say goodbye, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above, why must I be a teenager in love? Why must I be a teenager in love? Why must I be a teenager in love?
Now that I'm back in the studio, we'd like to thank our incredible team of directors and anyone who participated. If you think you might be interested in Drama Club or next year's middle school performance, feel free to talk to any cast member. I'm Alex Webster. This is OCMSN, and this has been your Spotlight Story.
Thank you, Alex. A great deal of work goes into a musical, doesn't it, Gabe?
It sure does, Bria. It's good to see so many students at the middle school involved in acting. They work very hard. Bria, what's up next?
The photo break is up next, with pics from the play rehearsal. We'll see you all on the flip side.
Welcome back. Up next is an interview with Mr. Basham. What's that all about, Bria?
Sarah Fox is doing a personal interview about the robotics club here at the middle school. So, Gabe, do you think there'll be a robot in every house someday?
Yes, I do. They can hold a lot more storage in their brains than we can. We are going to send it to Sarah Fox to check this interview out. Sarah?
I'm Sarah Fox, and I'm here with the founder and creator of the Oil City Middle School Robotics Club, Mr. Basham. Why did you decide to create the robotics club?
I attended a science training over in Columbus, Ohio last winter. And I took a class on how to start a robotics club, and I learned all the different programming and coding that all these other schools that were doing, even elementary schools. They had kindergartners, first graders doing all these different Lego Mindstorms and different kits. So I really wanted to bring it back to us after learning all of that at Columbus.
What did you have to do to get the program started here at the Oil City Middle School?
To actually get the program started, you needed, number one, money. You need a lot of money for some of the kits and things like that. So I ended up writing a grant for $6,000, and that got us started with all the equipment. The recent grant that I wrote here for the Spring Robotics Club was valued at $22,000. So we have almost $28,000 worth of science technology equipment.
What are your goals for the club?
The goals for my club is we have two clubs. We have a spring club and we have a competitive fall season club. The competitive fall season club goes on to actually compete in tournaments, whereas the spring one just learns how to do the programming and building the robots into kind of almost like a preseason for the competition. The goals, one of my goals after attending, I would like to see us get to Detroit, Michigan to the actual international global championships. It's a little bit of a stretch, but I think we could do it because we have some great learners here and great minds.
What skills are you looking for in the club members?
This is an interesting question because there are a lot of different levels of robotics and programming, and most people show up and they don't know how to do anything, and that was me too. When I showed up with this stuff, I didn't know what I was doing, and you have to learn it, and build it, and design it, and when you get through most of it, you don't realize how much smarter you get with the skills. So as far as math, you need to be excelling in math, you need to be working hard in science, you need to be able to engineer and work with your hands, because there's a lot of times that you have to take pieces apart and recreate what you design.
In your opinion, what are the most challenging skills to teach the members of your club?
I think the most challenging skills are the logic blocks of coding and the variables of coding. To get the robot to actually go forward and make a decision, not just turning decision, but being able to pick something up and transporting it to move somewhere is really difficult. We're still kind of working on that. I'm learning myself how to use the logic and the variable blocks, but the kids are doing a lot better with that.
If a student is interested in joining the robotics club, how would they do that?
To join the robotics club, the spring session's open to everybody, and the fall session coming up here there'll be an essay contest. You'll need to be able to write a solid essay on why you want to be a part of the robotics club. I don't do this because I want to single out people who are writing, but I need to see that students are committed and are willing to do it, because there's a lot of work. The kids on the robotics team who went to the competition put in close to 60 hours of preparation after school, so it's not something that they can just do after school for 30 minutes for fun and then forget about. If you're in the competitive group in the fall, you really have to take it on, almost like a basketball team or a cheerleading squad. There's a lot of work involved.
Thank you, Mr. Basham, for your time and devotion to our students here at the middle school. And thank you for allowing OCMSN to interview you. I'm Sarah Fox, and we now take you back to the studio with Bria Fennick and Gabe Swarm.
Great story, Sarah. Robots have come a long way. As you know, March 14th was Pi Day. Here at the middle school, we have a fifth grader that can do more than just say 3.14. Isn't that correct, Bria?
It sure is, Gabe. Fifth grade student Memphis Holver can recite Pi out to 417 places.
Are you kidding me?
Let's take a look.
Okay, we're going to give you a chance to do that in front of the camera. You ready?
Yes.
All right, here we go. Look right here. On the count of three. One, two, three. Begin.
3.14159265353848471976932975028814971649432072164062862892824254212071678214802124802654709382142120six six four seven zero nine three eight
046-095-505-8223-172. With 609-433-0572-703-138-414.
Give you that. And what's your grade in mathematics?
100, I think.
Well, I kind of thought so.
Welcome back. OCMSN would like to thank Memphis Oliver for his amazing ability to recite pi. It's quite the feat of memorization, wouldn't you say, Bria?
It sure is, Gabe. And that's our show for OCMSN. I'm Bria Fennick.
And I'm Gabe Swarm. Remember to stay positive. Good luck on the PSSAs.
One last thing, Gabe. All of us here at OCMSN hope you and your family had a wonderful Easter break. We will be back with our fourth and final episode. Until next time, this is OCMSN.